on Indian Air Force's force structure. Indian Armed Forces are operating in a unique environment. Presently, there are very few countries that are facing security challenges as great as ours. We got 15,000 kilometers of land borders, 7,500 kilometers of coastline, 3 billion square kilometers of airspace. We have fought 5 wars since independence. In all cases, we were invaded. We have a unique situation having 2 nuclear armed neighbors on our borders. No other country in the world is in this situation, the closest being South Korea and Israel. We are facing an insurgency which is aided from across the border, and we have a situation in which our adversaries are rapidly mobilizing, modernizing. We also have a responsibility of humanitarian assistance and disaster relief in our area of interest and contribute towards India's role as a net security provider in the Indian Ocean region on this aspect. So the planned force structure is based as per adversary's capabilities, because intentions can change overnight. The desired force structure is derived from a threat environment, which is being covered subsequently in the seminar by Air Marshal Bahadur. It's a combination of capability and numbers. The Indian Air Force is mandated to defend the nation in consonance with our sister services in the event of a two-front war. So, one of our adversaries, Pakistan, has approximately 20 fighter squadrons that can be brought to bear against us. In the last decade, China has significantly developed and upgraded road, rail and airfield infrastructure in the Tibetan Autonomous Region. In the last few years, fighter aircraft have been permanently stationed in the airfields in TAR. So have advanced radars and surface-to-air missiles. As per open source information, China has approximately 1,700 fighter aircraft, of which 800 are fourth generation. A large number of these can be expected deployed against us in the Tibetan Autonomous Region in case of hostilities. There are some limitations on parking and operating from there, but he's got enough reserves in depth to take care of his attrition. What we do not have are the numbers. Against the sanctioned strength of 42 squadrons, we are down to 31. Even when we do have 42 squadrons, we will be below the combined numbers of two of our regional adversaries. The question, which is being partially offset by getting high-tech aircraft. The question that is asked very often in the public debate is why 42 squadrons when older aircraft like MiG-21 are being replaced by more capable aircraft. The reasons are, first of all, our neighbors are not sitting idle. Pakistan has upgraded F-16 and made them 4.5 generation as far as avionics electronics goes, and is inducting JF-17 in large numbers. China is rapidly replacing its old fighters, its fourth generation fighter, and developing the fifth generation fighter, which is likely to be deployed very soon. Since our neighbors have replaced their second and third generation aircraft, modern aircraft, we also have to upgrade equally. Secondly, we need numbers to carry out full spectrum operations. Also, to absorb attrition. If we have to do only air defense, then obviously we can do with much lesser number of aircraft. We have to match the force level of our adversaries so that we can fight simultaneously on two fronts. These force levels will give us a conventional deterrence against our neighbors. As you all remember, we were thrust into the 1965 war as Pakistan perceived a conventional deterrence to be weak. Having the offensive capability to able to hit fast, very hard and in depth is what fighters in Air Force terms represent. Hence, they are extremely important for deterrence. Countries in similar situation as ours, South Korea and Israel, have invested heavily in their air power. Again, as per open source information, South Korea and Air Force and the USAF have about 170 third generation A-10 class and about 450 fourth generation aircraft stationed in the Korean Peninsula. Israel has about approximately 317 fourth generation and 12th fifth generation which they are inducting. And it has a definite superiority as far as air power is concerned over its regional rivals. To quote an ex-Israeli air chief, he said, "My job is to tell the other side that they don't have a military option," unquote. So why do we need to invest in high-end fighter aircraft given the exorbitant cost? In modern warfare, the other side has, which has a technological edge, the kill ratios will be very, very adverse, as we have seen with the Israeli fourth generation fighters fighting third generation Syrian fighters in the Bekaa Valley in 1982, with a kill ratio of 82-0. Can any side sustain such losses? And if you, even if you do it and you do, you are victorious, the victory will be pyrrhic. Many people quote Stalin and say, quantity has a quality of its own. While they themselves or their children don't fight battles, ask the person who is being sacrificed. My coursemate used to say, I quote, these armchair soldiers will fight till the last drop of your blood, unquote. Secondly, the erstwhile Soviet concept of fighting of a total war envisaged deployment with mass numbers and conscription. We as a democracy don't do it. And as a developing economy, we would be devastated if we invest in those kind of numbers. Hence, we need a force that can quickly respond, cause devastating damage to the other side, and get us peace on our terms. At the same time, I'm not saying all our fighters need to be high-end machines. You can operate low-end machines in the shadow of high-end machines, but only a limited number can fit under the protective umbrella of a high-end machine. We love to cherry-pick templates from the Western countries, but one must remember their investment in technology and training, which ensures that their fighters obliterate the enemy's air power before the ground forces move in and the UAV operates with impunity. The Indian Air Force is investing big time in the light combat aircraft. After the first two squadrons of LCA Mark I, we would have four squadrons of improved and technologically current LCA Mark I-A. Finally, 12 squadrons of LCA Mark II, which would be capable of replacing the MiG-29, the Mirage 2000, and the Jaguar aircraft. But we can't have an air force of only medium tech platforms. We need to have fighters which will win the high-end fight. The proposed induction of high-end fighter fits into this bill. The effect of air power with current technology is debilitating. It's not like the yesteryears. Let's start from independence, 47-48, Kashmir war. The role of air power was very limited. I quote from my predecessor, late Air Chief Marshal P.C. Lal. He said this in a lecture, seminal lecture on some problems on defense in USI National Security Lecture, Sapru House, 21st-22nd May 1975. I quote, IAF was made up of 8 fighter squadrons left after partition, bolstered with a few Liberator bombers salvaged from a World War II aircraft graveyard. I can understand the Army's reluctance to count on it, unquote. In the 65 war, we are all aware of the damage caused by 6 Sabres of PAF on our advancing army at the Ichogil Canal. So during 65 and 71 war, say a Sabre jet of PAF could carry, say, 2,000 pounds of bombs a day and give it a capability, say, X. By our Parakram, the modified Mirage 5 with night capability and onboard avionics, the capability would be 4X. And if you put this in today's F-16, CD, MA, or midlife upgraded, the capability will be 16 times the kind of damage that was done by the Sabre jets. So what happens now if a modern fighter is allowed to give him a free run to come over you? He'll put 8 tons of bombs with less than 20 meters accuracy. Therefore, in a conventional conflict, winning the air battle is imperative. If you don't win in the air, then nobody wins. Hence, whenever the government feels that the air power element of our defense force is likely to be in a disadvantageous position, we have gone in for emergency purchase of aircraft under the umbrella of an intergovernmental agreement. The history is that the government had undertaken emergency purchase of fighter aircraft on several occasions in the past. In January 1983, Pakistan Air Force inducted the first lot of F-16 aircraft, and in response to the serious threat, the government approached the Soviet Union, which at that time did not have a fourth-generation fighter. So they gave us 2 squadrons of MiG-23 MF, which was considered the best air defense interceptor aircraft available with the Soviet Union, which was purchased. Subsequently, when a fifth-generation fighter became available, 1985, we bought 2 squadrons of Mirage 2000 from France. In the coming years, as they showed interest in purchasing more F-16s, we bought again 2 squadrons of MiG-29 fourth generation fighters from the Soviet Union. it is pertinent to note that all these procurements were of two squadrons of fighter aircraft and under the umbrella of an intergovernmental agreement. The IGA facilitates faster procurement of equipment whenever a critical operational necessity arises and is the quickest means of achieving operational capability. The Indian Air Force during exercise Gagan Shakti exercised its plan B. It is not an optimum solution, but it is the best that we can do with the resources that we have got. It required a lot of planning time. And also, if the numbers are adequate, why would I shift forces? By providing the Rafale and the S-400, the government is strengthening the Indian Air Force to counter the shortfalls of our depleting numbers. Today's seminar will give you an insight on Indian Air Force plans and force structuring, as also the processes which aid it. I wish the participants and the audience all the success. Thank you and Jai Hind.